It mentions the standard contrail duration maximum of 2 minutes. That's the only hard figure that's in this report, which is similar to what I'd assumed it already was. It also states that ice supersaturation in the atmosphere may be the cause of persistent contrail formation, but no firm link is documented or established. They're just putting that out as an idea. But they quote a figure. This was useful because they quoted a figure of 150 kilometres is quoted for the maximum size of a region of ice supersaturation. I have measured chemtrails on satellite pictures and they're over 300 kilometres long. You can measure them. You go to the satellite website, download the picture, look at the pixel resolution and you can work out the length. Dead easy. And I've measured them at 300 kilometres long. This is in the report as well. And in this report of Ulrich Schumann's, there's only one optical photograph of trails in the sky. There's no time-lapse studies and there's nothing like that. I mean, I can do a time-lapse study of contrails for 10 quid. You know, this is a funded at university study and they can't even do a time-lapse study. I mean, this to me showed the quality of the data that was in this report was pretty poor, really, to be honest. So anyway, I wrote back to Roger Worth when I'd had a look at this report and basically said, look, you know, I've got some problems with this report you sent because it doesn't really answer these questions. And we had a bit of, you know, exchange over several emails and letters and things. And he said at the end of this, there is simply no evidence of unknown aerosols being covertly introduced, and to claim otherwise is distorting the facts. So my point is, and so what I've shown you so far, and I'm going to move on from here shortly, he ignores the time-lapse videos, I sent him a disc of that, he ignores the grid photos, which to me are particularly telling that these grids are appearing everywhere. He ignores the broken trails, he ignores the low-altitude trails, and the trails on some days and not others. Seems to be all in a day's work for these people. And I think that collection of pictures there proves beyond any doubt that there is a covert aerosol spraying program in operation. And that's just part of a set of pictures, obviously. Now, what was interesting to me was the response of non-governmental organisations who perhaps you'd expect to be a little more conciliatory than governmental organisations, but of course, you know, when you look into these things, as I'm sure people in the audience have, and who founded the World Wildlife Fund, you realise they too have their own agenda. But I wrote to Greenpeace with a report and they never responded. Later had an exchange in email with them when they were talking about carbon footprinting and this nonsense again. And they said, thanks for your email. It's interesting to hear your views. Your views. Now, of course, we don't have evidence. We have views. Okay, that's the language. As Greenpeace is absolutely going to continue campaigning on climate change, as it has been internationally for decades, I guess we will have to agree to differ on this one. And I have taken you off our supporter records as requested, because I said, well, look, if you're not going to look at chemtrails, then I'm really not interested in any of environmental movements, because it's basically largely irrelevant, you know. World Wildlife Fund responded, I am sorry you are disappointed in our response. We do not have the staff time and resources to address the issues you raise at this time. As I am sure you can appreciate, we have limited resources and staff and must address the most urgent issues that fall within our mandate. How interesting. Well, with that particular thing, they sent me my paper copy back. They sent it back through the post. I sent it to them and I said, I don't want it back. So why did they waste postage in an envelope from their limited resources to send it back to me? Seemed quite hypocritical to me, to be honest with you. And what investigation do you need? How about, well, let's go out of the office and watch. You know, go out in the morning. Any chemtrails? No. Let's go out the next day. You'll see them. It doesn't take any funds to investigate this. Now then went forward and sent some Freedom of Information responses. And I thought, you know, I'd got the grid picture. So that grid picture had to have been made with trails that were, you know, put out by something. Was it civilian aircraft? Was it military aircraft? And of course, in these days of international terrorism, which we all know is a fake, or if you don't, well, I'm here to tell you that it is, they should have surely a database of flights somewhere. They've got to know what flights are coming over the UK. Surely there must be this information for, you know, security reasons and everything related to that. So I said to them, look, what made these trails over my house on these dates, please? And I gave them two dates, the 10th of June, and when I'd got this photograph to prove they were there, and then the 4th of February when I made this video with the 42 aircraft. And I wrote to them, and they wrote back and said, the CAA, the Civil Aviation Authority, that is not directly involved in managing the traffic flows to and from the airports. That is the responsibility of the airports in conjunction with the relevant air traffic control organisation. For example, National Air Traffic Services, NATS. Therefore, the CAA is not directly involved in placing aircraft over Derby or any other areas. Neither does it have a remit to place any restrictions on aerial activity over any area for environmental reasons alone. Thus, the CAA does not have access to the information you requested. So the CAA couldn't tell me what flights went over my house. And I wrote to the Department of Transport as well. They directed me to NATS. I wrote to NATS as well and just didn't even get an intelligible response from them. I believe since then they've revised their website a bit, but even so, you'd expect that they could get the information on my behalf as part of the Freedom of Information request and then send it to me, rather than me having to go running around for it. The Department of Transport said it does not hold information on individual aircraft movements. The requirement to monitor traffic flows of aircraft movements is the responsibility of Air Navigation Service Provider, in this case NATS, and East Midlands Airport as the most significant airport nearest to Derby. So I thought, well, let's write to East Midlands Airport then, see what they say, which is what I did. I said it's about 5 miles from my house as a line of sight. These vapour trails are largely the result of aircraft operations at altitudes greater than 15,000 feet and therefore are unlikely to be associated with East Midlands Airport and would not be included in our radar recordings. So that means that the contrails must be above 15,000 feet. Chemtrails must be above 15,000 feet. Many flights pass over the middle of the country, including Derby. Whilst they include aircraft to and from East Midlands at higher altitudes, there are many aircraft associated with operations at other UK airports and many international flights, which of course is exactly what you would expect. You know, you wouldn't expect anything different. So they're basically saying we're only bothered about the traffic below 15,000 feet because that's the traffic we have to manage, which makes sense. You know, if you've got a limited team of 3 or 4 air traffic controllers, you're not going to want to be bothered with the stuff that's flying over. So I'm not going to read all that out, but basically it has yet to be proved to me that on those two dates that I have, nobody's been able to prove to me which flights caused those trails. I've still not got that information, and I'm working on this some more, but that's another story. But what's in chemtrails? If we established that they are actually real and they are, what's in them? What are they doing there? What substances have been found in them? Well, it's difficult to get a clear picture. Because it's an inaccessible domain. We can't get up there. We can't get up to 15,000 feet and take a sample. If we tried that, we'd have to be in the right place at the right time. But people have said there's things like barium and aluminium compounds. Okay? Some tests of water and soil samples seem to show elevated levels of these two substances. But genuinely proving the source is chemtrails is difficult, as authorities deny their very existence. You can't identify a source that is officially doesn't exist. Carnicom has reported other findings such as erythrocytes, which are like red blood cells. And they seem to have a biological component. But what are chemtrails for? Well, I've already mentioned that. Biowarfare, possibly. Covert biowarfare. But I don't think it's not for any beneficial reason at all. But it's an international program. So who sanctioned it? Who has the authority over it? That's what I would like to have an answer to. The other thing that people talk about is these strange fibres that are found on the ground sometimes. Now, there seems to be a bit of confusion between genuine spider webs and these other unusual long stringy fibres which seem to appear from time to time. And Cliff Carnicom describes in this, I'm not going to play the audio sample because we haven't really got time, but he describes the nanofibers, less than 7 microns, or about 7 microns in diameter, which is much thinner than a human hair. And he says he knows of no natural fiber that has those sorts of dimensions. So what are these things? You know, and I've seen some videos and films and stuff like that. And there does seem to be some very strange fibers present in some of these films and these pictures, but I don't really know what they are. And then we've got the link to Morgellons disease as well, where people have these fibres coming out of their skin. I don't know any Morgellons victims. So it's only what I've seen and heard on these various internet YouTube videos and whatnot. But some people say nanofibers are part of Morgellons disease. Is there a connection? I don't know. One thing I do know is that this chemtrail program is important because there is deliberate disinformation being put out about it. And I've got a couple of examples here. Now, this is said to be a spray pod exit port from a plane, and its brightness enhanced since it was in shadow of the sun. The brush-like object would provide maximum surface area to create an aerosol. Note the dark baffle, which will restrict airflow completely through the aerosol device. So this thing here, obviously. And this was from Ted Twightmire's website. He runs a website called Data for Science. It was posted on Rentz's website. And it supposedly was a chemtrail plane photographed on the ground. That's what this was put out as. However, it came out a day or two later. No, this was a known thing. It was either a refueling pod or a smoke generator. So this thing was known actually what it was. People knew what this was and were able to identify it as part of some standard military equipment. So that was deliberately put out, I think, as false information. In fact, something as large as that, you would be able to see that from the ground if it was used on all these planes that we see over us. You'd be able to see that. The other thing that we had was inside a chemtrailer, which came out in February 2000. No, this was actually earlier. I think the date on that might be wrong. Mind you, that's 2 years ago now, so it might be right. The date might be right. This was said to be inside a chemtrailing plane. This was revealed on the Cloak and Dagger website originally. I think it's since got taken down from there, but there's still obviously copies all over the internet. And it was said that these tanks were the chemtrail spray. Not true. Not true. This is a flight test. And here you have these systems here, which this is all labelled up. I won't read out all the labels. But basically, the fluid is pumped around the aircraft between these tanks, which is to measure the performance of the airframe. That's what it's for, to simulate passengers being in one location or, you know, luggage being loaded in one location or whatever. And they have a bank of computers to monitor the performance of the aircraft during this test. And there are other pictures as well. I don't think I've put it in this presentation, but people in the background filling in paperwork with the tanks. You know, they were resting on top of these tanks and filling in paperwork. So we can see that there have been examples of deliberate disinformation being put out to do with chemtrails. This happens a lot, actually. Not just with chemtrails, but with all this stuff. But now what I'm going to move on to is what I think is what chemtrails are primarily involved with, or if even if they aren't, then there's good evidence that this is actually happening, which is weather modification and geoengineering. I mean, we've heard a little bit, I think recently, the Beijing Olympics, they said that the Chinese seeded the clouds to create rain, and I think there's a story earlier this year that they seeded the clouds and generated 16 million tons of snow. So we are hearing a bit about that sort of weather modification, but that's nothing new. We've known about cloud seeding for a long time. Not a lot of people know. I was only made aware of this story, another talk I did probably 3 or 4 years ago now, and somebody told me this story, and I could only remember the sketchy details, but I managed to find out what it was. There have been various geoengineering operations in the last 100 years. In 1915, the San Diego City Council approached Charles Hatfield to produce rain to fill the Marina Dam Reservoir. He claimed to be a rainmaker, and Hatfield with his brother built a 20-foot tower beside Lake Marina, and he was ready early in the new year, so 1916. They used a secret mixture of chemicals, it says. Starting on 5th of January 1916, it rained for 15 days and caused floods and dams to burst. And Hatfield was blamed for this damage. So apparently it was a successful weather modification project. That's what it looked like on the surface. And this again was wrapped up in controversy, and he was called a fake and a fraud and everything. Nevertheless, the story was the inspiration behind the 1956 Burt Lancaster film, The Rainmaker. So there you go, there is some documentation for that. Now, I'll just mention briefly the cloud seeding. Irving Langmuir seeded cloud with dry ice in 1946. Then Bernard Vonnegut started the silver iodide seeding because silver iodide has a particular property. The crystal lattice constant is of a particular size that it's conducive to helping water condense out of the atmosphere.